I'm an obstetrician. I work in this island. This is in Sardinia, and they are famous for two things. One is for cost, of the sea, the Emerald Coast, where the richest people in the world go there. And the other thing is for a disease that the name is thalassemia, or beta thalassemia, that also is present in this area, in Pakistan and in India, but is present in the Mediterranean area. And I would like to speak about tutoring transabdominal chorionic valve. This is a procedure for many genetic diseases. It's a first trimester procedure. Okay. First of all, I would like to show you the diploma of invasive prenatal procedure as a chorionic villus sample or amniocentesis or beta blood sample or other procedure that I do in my department in Sardinia, in my hospital, thanks to Professor Asim Kuliak and Professor Frank Cerver, they are the director of Young Donald School. People come to my hospital for a stage for 1 or 2 or 3 weeks or maybe more to improve or to learn this technique. And at the end of this stage, I give that diploma of invasive prenatal procedure that is under the umbrella of Young Donald School, that also is under the umbrella of World Association of Prenatal Medicine. As you know, maybe I don't know if the audience is an obstetrician or radiologist or something else, but there are many procedures in prenatal and pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. I show you the principal, the most common prenatal diagnosis. Some are in pregnancy. Chorionic villus sample at the first trimester of pregnancy between the following 10 weeks of gestation. The second is amniocentesis following 50 weeks of gestation, maybe is more popular. And this is the cordocentesis of fetal blood sampling following 18 weeks of gestation. There is also in vitro very early prenatal diagnosis, named pre-implantation genetic diagnosis with the blastomer technique, aspiration. In Cagliari, in my center, following 1977, I make more than 50,000 invasive procedures of this and also following other. And in the 1977 in Sardinia, in Cagliari, there was done the first prenatal diagnosis of beta thalassemia. Beta thalassemia is a genetic blood anomaly with severe anemia in the fetus and the newborn, and is very common in Mediterranean area. And between two carriers, we can have 25% of probability to have a fetus affected. In 1977, we do in Cagliari the first prenatal diagnosis by aspiration from the placenta from fetal blood sampling, and the analysis was done by chain globin at 20 weeks of gestation. Following them, we do more than 6,000 cases of beta thalassemia in my department. And you can see here in this our study, published 2006, that until 2004, we have more than 35,000 cases in my department for prenatal diagnosis of beta thalassemia and the chromosomopathy and of karyotype analysis. Of course, we had also other invasive procedures for other genetic diseases. And you can see here our invasive procedures, such as placentosynthesis, ketoscopy, cortosynthesis, cardiosynthesis, amniotic fluid, transcervical chorionic intrusampis, transadenal chorionic intrusampis. We left this placenta synthesis, leave this endoscopy and the cardiosynthesis, but we do only of this transadominal and amniotic fluid and the blood sampling by cortosynthesis at that time. But why we start in Italy by invasive procedure, but you can see here in Europe the invasive testing rate by for karyotype and of other genetic diseases. You can see that in Italy 50% of population of pregnant women do prenatal invasive procedure. And the other are less country where prenatal invasive testing is less. This is because in Italy the first pregnancy is is not too early, and all the women at the first pregnancy are the majority are 35 years old. Then there are several factors that influence the estimate of the incidence of prevalence in the newborn of congenital malformation or genetic disorder or genetic anomalies, and you can see from Milansky that is the Bible of genetic disease. This is my hand in gallery publishing the cover of this big Bible of genetic disorder, and you can see that there are many factors, new. There are all the factors such as maternal age, but there are also new, as for example, maternal obesity, family history, consanguinity, of IVF, or intracytoplasmic sperm injection, season of the year. There are many things that I can't read everything. And one of the most important for the indication for invasive procedure is a nuchal translucency first trimester screening for Down syndrome by ultrasound from 11 to 14 weeks of gestation. You can see here that following 1996 in my department we do more, until 2011 we performed more than 80,000 cases of nuchal translucency screening in the first trimester and also nasal bone sac and other markers. And you can see that every year we do more than 60 and 7,000 cases for a year, and that does mean that more than 60% of newborn in Sardinia receive this test. We have just 12,000 newborn per year in Sardinia. Sardinia is not as Lahore, is 1 million and 600,000 or 700,000 inhabitants. Then this is more than 60% of this test is done in my department. And this is an important social aspect of screening. And you can see here the genetic test in Cagliari, the distribution. You can see that following chorionic sampling, we do more than 100% of Mendelian disorders, such as beta thalassemia, cystic fibrosis, and others. And also, following the first trimester nuchal translucency and the biochemical screening, we used also chorionic sampling. And we use amniocentesis for maternal age in 60%, and also for karyotype for multiple anomalies. And following the second trimester biochemical screening, we use amnio. And we use the fetal blood sampling in this case, which for congenital infection of IUGI. Then you can see, I will speak about chorionic sampling because everybody knows the amniocentesis, and then and because in my department many people foreign people come to my department to learn this technique. This is transadominal chorionic sampling in the first trimester. You can see here the needle in the posterior placenta and is inserted tangentially to the scanner, pre-end technique with the movement up and down, with connected to the 20 millionth of syringe. And I'll show you later. Then, if you see this slide about American College of Obstetric Gynecology, you see that the invasive diagnosis testing for aneuploidy should be available to all women regardless of maternal age. In Italy, we use also maternal age, but we use also this indication for genetic counseling and genetic test. And you can see that also the guideline of Royal College that the screening is very important for indication for amniocentesis or chorionic sampling in the UK. They do more than 5%. There are many things that you must consider following transdominant chorionic sampling. The most important thing, of course, that regards the women are fetal loss, and the following chorionic venous sample, transdominant chorionic venous sample, in expert hands, the detection rate of fetal loss is from 0.5% to 1%. Of course, depend on the operator experience. This is the most important. The instrument, the needle that you use, of course, is important also maternal and gestational age. The attempt that you do, the quantity of milligram of chorionic venous sampling, if there is some associated pelvic pathology, if there is a bleeding, of course, multiple pregnancy, that we can have more fetal loss. But you can also have some problem if you use chorionic venous sample before the mix of gestation, and then you can see here the recommendation for and the criteria for chorionic venous sample that WHO suggested that the chorionic venous sample must be done only in center at high level of expertise, following counseling and never before the mix of gestation with a good outcome of newborn and by ultrasound at 18, 10, 20 weeks of gestation. There are several endpoints that is important in training in prenatal invasive procedure. Of course, the most important is fetal loss. We must consider the total fetal loss. You can also consider if you need several other insertion, the failure and the success of the procedure, the velocity at the time of the procedure, and the choice, patient choice for the procedure. In the past, we start every center starts by the transcervical chorionic venous sample, but now the most accepted is the transabdominal chorionic venous sample, because it's more acceptable also from the women. And when you consider the fetal loss, you must consider the fetal loss regarding if it happens 60 days after the procedure, or 30 days following, or 4 weeks after, or after 24 weeks. Also, you must consider also premature rupture of membrane and the perinatal mortality or problems. Sometimes when you are teaching invasive procedure, you must consider that the tutor, the senior tutor, must do maybe a second procedure because of a failure of the fellow. But how can we solve this problem? We can introduce the subspecialty maternal fetal medicine following obstetric gynecology speciality. This is done in the United States and in UK, but not in all center. Or you can training as fellow in maternal fetal medicine department, such as my department or other department in Europe, in Asia, or everywhere they do. And you can also use a Bantam or simulation model for tutoring, and you can also perform the procedure under guidance, under ultrasound guidance, and also you must complete the exact number of procedure before starting in autonomy. This is also important. Also important is to have a continuous audit and a continual review of certificate operator. As regarding the society, international society, you can see that the Dutch Society of Obstetric and Gynecology suggests at least 30 guided procedures before starting to be independent. The Italian Society of Obstetric and Gynecology and Ultrasound, where I am the president, suggests the number of procedures necessary under guidance. There is no quantification, but just another weighted number of procedures. And in the UK, at least 30 guided procedures in a year for chorionic sample or amnio before starting. Is that by the Latin Colonial College? And it is a study in chorionic venous sampling for training in Stanford in California that suggests that the fellow is responsible for participating and assisting directly as first assistant. This is very important because if you look at the senior tutor when they do the procedure, you can later you can have more probability, more rate to improve your technique. And if you see here, you can see the model, the pattern for teaching ultrasound, the guiding basic procedure in the medicine. You can see from here, from in France, from Bill, and all you can use this device inside of connected directly to the scanner, to the ultrasound scanner. But I use the freehand technique that for me and is easier. And I wanted to show my personal experience in my department for chorionic venous sampling. I started in 1982 by transcervical CVS in Paris using transcervical biopsy forceps. Me and Yves Dumay were the pioneers in this technique in 1982, and then using Cagliari transcervical CVS in the same time using biopsy forceps in termination of pregnancy and during malformation. And for transabdominal chorionic venous sampling, we use a freehand technique in 1985 during amniocentesis and in volunteer termination and fetal malformation. I show you later this technique following amniocentesis to improve yourself with this technique. If you are able to do amniocentesis, it's easier for you to do this technique. This is the transcervical CVS. And by rigid biopsy forceps that I used in the past. And this is by catheter, is another technique published in the Minaski edition. And this is my technique about the abdominal chorionic venous sampling. You can see that here is the probe, this is the needle connected with the syringe, this is the placenta. You can see here is not fixed in the translucent in the scanner, but this is tangentially to the scanner, and this is the needle inserted in the placenta. You can see in the movement later. You see here the technique in this movie. I introduce the needle in the placenta. You can see here, and this. This technique the time is just 5 or 10 seconds. Maybe it's more just for teaching. And you can see the movement up and down in aspiration with the syringe, 2 milliliter of syringe. We aspirate the chorionic venous sample that is sufficient for genetic disease. Some people say that when the placenta is completely posterior, there are no space to introduce the needle. But if there is in this situation that occur in 2 or 3% of the cases when the uterus is completely retroverted, an assistant can move the uterus and to put the placenta in that direction, and then you can aspirate the tissue. Then this is my personal experience in Cagliari since 1982 to 2011. You can see here that we do more than 20,000 abdominal chorionic sample by freehand technique, and the weeks were between 6 and 34, but the margin, the 90 99% were done between 11 and 12 weeks of gestation. We have no failure. We have just two of these diagnosed, two failure, and the fetal loss rate was 0.8%. Then, in conclusion, you can do training in this procedure by a senior tutor supervision following a period as fair assistant to look at the procedure, and I suggest also some tricks, suggestion for transdominal CVS. Initially, it's better to use an 18-gauge needle instead of a 20-gauge needle, and also it's better to start at 13 weeks gestation because the placenta is larger and then it's easy for you to at the beginning, and also you must do the first attempt during second trimester of the I show you later, and you can learn also this technique in voluntary termination of pregnancy or in malformed fetus, and also the bladder, you must consider the bladder must be empty or full. You can see this movie following amniocentesis. This is an amniocentesis. You can see here the amnio. And the following the amnio, you can see here the needle. You switch off the needle here in the placenta. This is a 50 weeks of gestation, but it's just to learn this technique of aspiration in the placenta. Then we connected the needle now with the syringe, and with the movement up and down, we aspirated the chorionic sound. This is just to teach when you are able to do this technique in the second trimester during the amniocentesis, you can see here the up and down movement, then you can aspirate and you are learning, you are able to do this procedure in the first trimester of pregnancy. You can see here the movement up and down following the amniocentesis, of course. Look, the aspiration up and down. Okay, finished. Then, teaching that this is the last chorionic loop sample. I had 16 regional fellows, 62 Italian fellows, and 59 foreign fellows. The most are from the United States because the United States is not easy to have a tutoring in chorionic loop sampling. And that my two students, no students, they are obstetricians from abroad. One is from Denver, Colorado, from John Hopkins Clinic, and this is from Mongolia, that it was last week in my department. Thank you for your attention.